Penguin Random House Audio presents The Monster in the Hollows, The Wingfeather Saga, Book 3. Written and read by Andrew Peterson.
Chapter 1, A Smoldering Silence. It wasn't a sound that woke Janner Igiby. It was a silence. Something was wrong. He strained into a sitting position, wincing at the pain in his neck, shoulders, and thighs. Every time he moved, he was reminded of the claws and teeth that had caused his wounds. He expected to see the bearer of those claws and teeth asleep in the bunk beside him, but his brother was gone. Sunlight fell through the porthole and slid to and fro across the empty mattress like a pendulum, keeping time with the rocking of the boat. The other bunk's bedclothes were in a heap on the floor, which was typical. Kalmar never made his bed back in Glipwood, either. What wasn't typical was his absence. For weeks, Janner and Kalmar had lain in their bunks all day, Janner recovering from his wounds, Kalmar keeping him company. Every time Janner woke, he found his furry brother in his bunk, usually with a sketchbook in his lap. The scritch-scritch of Kalmar's quill each morning was as comforting as birdsong. Janner liked to lie awake for a few minutes before he opened his eyes, listening to Kalmar's breathing, reminding himself that the creature beside him was, in fact, his little brother. He still wasn't used to the way he looked, covered in fur, or to the husky growl at the edge of his 11-year-old voice. But his breathing was the same, and so were his eyes. If Janner ever doubted, he just had to look at those bright blue eyes to know that beneath the wolfish fur was a little boy. Janner took a deep breath and swung his feet to the floor. His wounds stung. His thighs were wrapped in bandages, and he winced when he saw the dark stains there. Nia and Leeli would have to change the dressing again, and that meant more pain. Janner took a moment to muster the energy to stand, something he had seldom done alone since he'd been wounded. He shuddered at the cold memory, the shock of the icy water when he plunged in after Kalmar, the hot sting of claws digging into his thighs as the little gray fang kicked against his embrace, claws scraping against his back and tearing his shirt to shreds, and, worst of all, the sharp teeth as they bit into his shoulder and neck, his brother's teeth. The ship creaked and fell silent again. Since the day they had sailed away from the ice prairies, the ship had seemed like a living thing. It groaned like an old man sleeping. It coughed when the sails luffed. It sighed when they tacked into a happy wind. The crew shouted and laughed at all hours of the day, and even at night, Janner was kept company by the slapping of waves against the hull and the murmur of sailors keeping watch. And then there was the heartbeat of the ship, Poto Helmer. Janner's peg-legged grandfather marched from fore to aft, starboard to port, the steady tap, clunk of his footsteps beating deep into the night, keeping the ship alive and all its passengers with it. The old man's voice boomed and bellowed, a presence so constant that if Janner ever wondered where Poto was, he had but to listen for a moment to hear either a barked command, a burst of laughter, or the beat of his wooden stump on the deck. But now the ship's heart had stopped beating, and that was the silence that had woken Janner. Neither the odd calm of the waters, nor the silence of the crew, nor even Kalmar's absence were as troubling as the utter stillness of Poto Helmer. It was as if the old man had disappeared. Then, as if to confirm Janner's sense of dread, there came to his nostrils the unmistakable smell of smoke. Janner stood too fast, and the pain in his legs, neck, and back made him dizzy. But he didn't care. He had to find out what was happening on deck, even if just to be sure that he wasn't stuck in a nightmare. Janner took three steps towards the stairs, and the hatch flew open. Light poured into the hold.
"Janner, my boy, what are you doing out of bed? In the words of Mildred Entwood, you've been badly wounded by your brother's clawful attack."
Oscar N. Retief's round form filled the hatchway, blocking the sunlight like an eclipse. "Mr. Retief, what's wrong? Where did everybody go? Why do I smell smoke?" Janner took a step forward and winced as another pang shot up his leg. Oscar jiggled down the stairs to Janner's side.
"Easy then, that's it, lad."
He took Janner by the arm and helped him forward. Janner asked again, "What's happening?" Oscar pushed up his spectacles and wiped his sweaty pate.
"Everything's all right, lad. Everything's all right."
Oscar, who used to spend all his time puffing on a pipe at his desk in the rear office of Books and Crannies, who had only ever read about real adventures and who had never been on a ship before, was as close to being a sailor as he would ever be. He was barefoot. His breeches were cut off at the shin, and he wore a sleeveless shirt, which allowed him to proudly display his new tattoo. And though he was no smaller and no less squishy, He seemed healthier. If everything's all right, why do I smell smoke? Are the fangs back? The seven fangs they'd subdued on the ship when they escaped Chimera had gotten rowdier by the day. They had howled and scratched at the stowage walls until it became clear that they wouldn't stop until they scraped their way out. The Chimerans wanted to execute them, but Nia wouldn't allow it. 2 weeks into the voyage, Poto decided to set them adrift on a little skiff with a jug of water, assuring everyone that it was as good as an execution, and that if the Maker wanted them to survive, it was up to him to arrange it. Janner had lain awake many nights imagining they'd somehow catch up to them, slip aboard, and kill the crew in their sleep. Oscar waved his hand as they mounted the first step.
No, no, those wolves are gone. Your mother sent me to bring you topside.
Oscar's face turned grave.
There's something you need to see.
Janner had always been impatient when it came to getting answers. With his legs hurt, the 8 steps to the deck were likely to be an arduous journey, and he didn't want to wait that long. What is it? Please, Mr. Retief.
No, lad. This is a thing to see, not to hear about. Now bear up and come on.
Janner took his old friend's arm and eased his way up the steps into the sunlight. When his eyes had adjusted, he saw the open sea for the first time since they'd set sail. He had seen the ocean from the cliffs back home, stretching out forever east, and he had seen it when they escaped the ice prairies, with the frozen crags at his back. But now it surrounded him. The effect was dizzying. The dark sea of darkness was vast and terrible to behold. It quickened his pulse and took his breath, and he knew in an instant that he loved it. He thought of the little sketch of his father sailing alone on his 12th birthday, and how he had gazed at the picture for hours and longed to do the same. The smell of the sea, the sun on the water, and the knowledge of his father's love for sailing rushed at Janner like a rogue wave and sent his heart spinning. The exhilaration faded when the breeze shifted and the sharp smell of smoke invaded his thoughts again. He pulled his eyes from the ocean and noticed that everyone on the ship was on deck, standing at the port rail, looking silently south at a cloudy sky. Standing among the crew was a tall, beautiful woman, her left hand on a little girl's shoulder and her right on the shoulder of a little gray fang. Beside them stood Poto, shirtless and strong with what looked like a club in one hand.
Come on, lad, Oscar said, and Nia, Leeli, Kalmar, and Poto turned to greet him.
Seeing them together gave Janner strength. He pulled away from Oscar and limped into his mother's arms. His legs, neck, and back stung, but he didn't care anymore. He had seen each member of his family over the weeks of his recovery, but never all at once. He felt Poto's hand on his head, Leeli's cheek against his shoulder, his mother's arms enfolding him without jarring his wounds, and Kalmar's hand on his forearm. Then he felt Kalmar's claws. And though he didn't want to, he cringed. Only a little, but enough to break the happy spell of his family's welcome. Good morning, son, Nia said, taking his face in her hands. She smiled at him, but there was grief in her eyes. Janner could see she'd shed tears recently. Leeli didn't say a word, but held Janner's hand and looked out at the gray horizon. Mama, what is it? Janner asked. Why won't anyone tell me what's happening? Nia helped Janner to the railing and pointed at the horizon. Look. But Janner didn't see anything unusual. The waters were eerily calm, as if the dark sea were holding its breath. It felt like their ship was trespassing. But that wasn't anything to look at, was it? Everyone on the ship was staring at something, but Janner only saw clouds. Then he remembered the smell of smoke, and he knew. Those aren't clouds, are they? Poto shifted on his wooden leg and shook his head.
No, laddie, they aren't.
It's smoke, Janner said. All the maps Janner had ever studied sped through his mind. He saw continents and countries fly past, with their rivers and borders and forests. He saw Scree and the Foob Islands and the wide expanse of the Dark Sea of Darkness, and then he saw, in his imagination, their ship approaching the green hollows in the east. There, just to the south of where Janner guessed they might be, was a little island off the northwestern coast of Dang.
Anniera, said Janner. The Shining Isle. Aye, lad. 9 long years, Poto said, and it's still burning.
Chapter 2, A Haven in the Hollows. If Janner had ever wondered if Anniera was a real place, now he knew. He didn't just know by the awful smoke choking the sky or its scent on the wind, but by the look in his mother's eyes. It was as if the churn of the dark sea had abandoned the waters and left them calm, only to inhabit the eyes of Nia Wingfeather. When Janner looked up at her, he saw sorrow, anger, pain, and fear passing over her face like colliding waves, stirring the deep waters of remembrance. More than ever, Janner believed. He believed because to his mother, Anniera wasn't just a story.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.